This is Planet Crunch Part 1, including biodiversity, forests, farming, fishing, and shopping. Part 1 of 3. The news about the planet and us changes every hour, every day, every week, all the time, in fact. In the years up to 2020, towards 2021 and beyond, it switches between good and very bad. 2020 has not been a great year, but with the pandemic, climate change, and the decline of biodiversity, in other words, the natural world. This film is mainly about that, but inevitably it includes many other aspects of our lives as they affect planet Earth and our future on it. This is a perspective that may surprise you, may make you angry, certainly disagree, and that might turn out to be a useful ingredient. The content of the newspapers has reached the front pages, the headlines across the world. Everyone, every living thing, could be in there these days. It spans from the rainforest to the birds on our bird tables, to the great whales down deep in the oceans. And if it's happening there, it could be news in a newspaper, or on radio or television, social media, or these days, almost any way you want to get it. Two years of pivotal, critical change affecting the lives of billions of people around the world. The media, in all its forms, will drive my quest to assess 2 years in the life or death of planet Earth. It's fascinating, I can assure you. Even on a wall by a supermarket in Bristol, England, that surprising schoolgirl from Sweden, Greta Thunberg, plus polar bear, the symbol of climate change, share the Aldi car park with consumers like you and I, as we consume products from all over the world. You could say the buck stops here, and as Greta says, we are watching. And we'll be seeing what she sees, and find out where all this stuff comes from. In fact, the real cost of the planet, of what we buy and use every day, and how that is changing all the time, according to the source, whether it's the petrol in our cars, food from the farm, fish from the sea, wood and paper from the forests, fruit from the tropics, the controversial plastic and bottled water. We waste a lot. Some can't spend, as Boris Johnson urges, apparently unaware that that may prove to be a policy of disaster later on, and we'll see. In the meantime, whether it's people, poor or rich, or pecking pigeons, it's survival of the fittest, and in the battle of the supermarkets, the battle of the cheapest, as is more on the media. Photos, moving and static, all sorts of sound and vision. And earphones. The media everywhere. We look at fashion, fast and otherwise, and how it's changing. Fake fur, or otherwise farming animals for fur. Farming animals for food with health problems that can follow. Similarly, more and more humans are increasingly a problem for the planet in so many, many ways. And we'll look at the big corporations, the travel industry, energy, and especially nature and us, and what's being done to help it all around the world. This is Planet Crunch in three parts. Dependent on the sun, we're out there as a blue, brown, and green dot. Unique. Wonderful. Yes, full of wonders.
The bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by.
It's now a world of winners and losers, and it's usually us that causes those changes, for good and bad. What is affected is biodiversity. And we move quickly through the plant and animal kingdoms. That variety is evident, adapted to all sorts of conditions. Flowers are pollinated by bees, butterflies, and other insects as they feed on nectar. Our own survival depends crucially on the continuing success of these interactions. Some orchids bloom at just the right time and emit scents that attract specific insects. Certain members of the bee orchid family have even evolved to look like their pollinators. One site in Wales with over 10 orchid species is ideal for observing this miracle of nature. And someone who appreciates the links between plants and insects is Sir David Attenborough.
A buddleia bush, and on it peacock butterflies, red admirals, tortoise shells. Is there anything that's more colourful, more beautiful, and more widely enjoyed in our gardens and the countryside than those butterflies? And if you get hooked on those, well, of course, there are other more modest, shyer beauties that will give you delights and thrills. There are small blues and fritillaries and clouded yellows and orange tips. There are actually over 50 of these gorgeous things in our countryside. Of course, it's not just that they give us great pleasure. They're also very, very important because in a way, they are like canaries in a coal mine. They are indicators of the health of the natural world and of our environment. So knowing about them is not just a matter of pleasure and, as it were, rather abstruse and specialist delight. It's extremely valuable. Britain, as a whole, is quite remarkable in the number of people who take an interest in butterflies, not simply as professionals, but as a hobby, but do it to fully professional standards. The expert naturalist is a British tradition, which goes back to the 18th century, if not earlier, and it's one of which we're very proud. And one of the most amazing manifestations of it is this. This book is the accumulated knowledge and wisdom of hundreds, literally hundreds, of highly expert observers in Britain. They all belong to an organisation called Butterfly Conservation. And what they've produced in this marvellous book is a definitive survey of all the species of butterflies in this country, how they are getting on, where they are to be found, and what their habits are. It's a miraculous document, and it documents a great wonder.
The diversity of butterflies and also moths in Britain is just one example of how basic designs can evolve into different sizes, shapes, and colours. Linked to a variety of food plants, with different types of life cycle, egg, caterpillar, chrysalis and adult, they've come to utilize a multitude of niches, reducing competition and increasing potential. However, some will be winners and others losers, as climate change affects some species, as does farming and the way we treat the land and its plants. That's all the 58 or so British species in that vast global group, the insects. In evolution, from the invertebrates came the vertebrates, the backbone animals. Fish led to amphibians such as frogs, with thousands of species around the world in a wide range of habitats. Then came the reptiles, not tied to water and with a waterproof skin. The snake's tongue seems to intrigue the fish, but will the trick work? That one's too big and has to go. And so do they. Reptiles also include a wide range of lizards with tongues that can taste the air. Over a long time, scales became feathers and the first birds were born in the evolutionary story. Some kinds live mainly on the ground, like these guinea fowl. Others, like these shorebirds, sometimes called globe spanners, can move like smoke across the world.
Special.
And swans, some of the biggest birds, are very versatile. And so is the otter, a mammal, next up from the birds. Now back in numbers, right across Britain, even in cities, it just goes to show that when hunting and pollution is removed, this charming animal can bounce back with all the adaptive powers that mammals have come to possess. And finally to the apes, like chimpanzees, which eat figs. But also sometimes hunt and kill monkeys. Not their relative man, though. Here in Uganda, they both need the forest. It could be for firewood. It's home for both, including researchers, but it's a crunch point for our next main section after biodiversity. Forests. It's where man and nature collide. Not the local wood gatherer, but powerful people thousands of miles away. Home for local people, but with their forest support replaced by a commodity enjoyed by millions of very different people. The land's been cleared to grow sugar. Such corporations are huge and powerful. Local people, chimps, and a wondrous biodiversity of wildlife are not. They are the losers, as the monoculture, effectively sterile, stretches across a green desert of sugar, feeding a factory with an apparently insatiable appetite, in turn feeding supermarkets around a changing planet. This is the true cost of many products we use. It's the first of the four Fs: forests, then farming on the cleared land, fishing worldwide, and the food we need. Parrots, bees, flowers, a leopard, part of that vital web of life that can be wrecked without us thinking or knowing about it. Sugar in your tea? The real price is much of the forests of Sri Lanka. And as with sugar, a green monoculture surrounds the only original tree left standing. That tea's on the way. But the plant that's made the biggest impact of all is the oil palm. Now grown in large plantations in many tropical countries, especially Indonesia and Malaysia. It's exported and used almost everywhere in the world. Forests can potentially provide for people forever if they're kept sustainable, replanted, and protected for the future. It can be a win-win. But it also can be a no-no, like this hardwood timber for our furniture. Plus a clue to the bushmeat trade, a chimp's finger infected perhaps with Ebola, like COVID. Timber, chimp, bananas, all products of the forest as long as it's there. We now have such power over nature to manipulate it for whatever reason, but we do this at our peril. Soil is the basis of most plant life. Chemicals can kill it and turn it into desert. So we all lose, the plants, animals, and ultimately us. Another powerful tool we can use is fire, whether it's for managing grouse shooting in England or sugarcane in Mauritius. The results can look similar. A damaged landscape because of human intervention. And that's particularly obvious with the way we have put animals on the land to graze it and sometimes overgraze it. To the bone. Our next F, farming. That's mainly sheep, cattle, pigs, and goats. We like lamb, well, with mint sauce. Come in number 19, your time is up. Sheep turn grass into meat and wool, and that's a massive industry worldwide, from the highest mountains down to sea level. Here in hot central Spain, sheep provide a supporting role to cattle egrets, therefore sheep egrets. The dry grass is home to insects, which the sheep disturb using a trick that's enabled them to spread around the world, wherever there's man's livestock offering a ride. We've moved from personal cows to thousands massed in pens for the burger business. And battery chickens, basically factory farming. But the ancient links still prevail, as at this festival in Sardinia, Italy. Candelas de Pualui, de moya sadorrada, de geluvenza dui. They're rejoicing about their animals, their plants, their fruit and their vegetables, and their crucial land. Now for the next F, fishing. So far, we've seen how biodiversity is important in F for forests, F for farming, and now F for fishing for our food, another F. The oceans cover some 70% of the planet's surface. Crunch is evident as we raid our forests and farm our landscapes. The sea is an extraordinary ecosystem based on plankton you can't see, being sieved out by the world's second biggest fish after the whale shark, the basking shark. Up the food chain to the Arctic tern, which migrates to and from the Arctic to the Antarctic every year, an astonishing feat, all fueled by small fish and thus plankton. The same applies to the shags and cormorants. Here tackling an eel, another long-distant migrant from rivers in Europe across the Atlantic to spawn. Across the Atlantic too, and also in rivers as well, and hunted by both heron and man, the famous and valuable king of fish, the salmon. Wild-caught salmon is much more expensive than the farmed version. In an industry beset by lice, pollution and escapees mixing with wild salmon, thus degrading the stock. People have fished the seas for years, as here in Sri Lanka, from stilts. And there's a threat out there that's increasingly common. From the old days onwards, nets have worked better and better, but for less and less. Overfishing is becoming a huge problem. The seas must look vast, but there's a limit as to how much we can take from it. And can quotas work? Well, only if they're enforced. We seem to be too greedy to care, despite the oceans having so much potential. Take that tuna, for example. A fantastic resource, possibly forever, but now overfished to feed us. Man, top of the food chain again. So it's back to the supermarkets and their massive appetite for stuff of all sorts, from flowers to flour and chocolate to loo rolls, sold out in COVID-19. And all right for some, not at all for others. Not for them the endless stream of recipes and television shows that seem to idolize food, whilst half the world is starving. It's not only the needs and greed of the human population, but its impact on nature and the climate, such as deforestation for beef and soya, grown to feed animals we then eat. Greta and I will keep on watching, using the media to keep us up to date. There's quite a bit of bad news in this part one.
Current position.
In the second part, we'll get a better message for a change. In the first of our Fs, in the rainforest, and tune into an imaginary conversation between two gorillas about a certain film crew's visit and a chap who really joined in. Question. Where does a big silverback gorilla sit? Answer, anywhere he wants. There's a lively, free Planet Crunch book to go with the film series. For details, visit brockinitiative.org. End of part one of three. This is Planet Crunch Part 2, including tourism, the media, population, nature and us, and money. Part 2 of 3. They say if you build it, they will come. To Dubai, the tallest of the tall, as they proudly claim. But why are people leaving this extraordinary city in the sand, also known as Blingon Sea? After all, it has a super aquarium, complete with otters and penguins, here in the baking desert. And a vast shopping mall, one of many in Dubai. Then, of course, the snow and skiing. And next to that snow, the food, most of which, as with almost everything else, has to be imported by ship or plane, with worrying results, as we'll see. This is a weird world where consumption, be it a dead animal like an Arctic fox from far away, and here on a stupid woman, runs riot in lifestyles that are probably unsustainable. Shop till you drop, they say. But we'll need at least the equivalent of two more planet Earths to survive, and there just aren't any. It turned out to be a very shaky, insecure place. A financial collapse caused panic. People jumped in their fancy cars and headed for the airport, and just left them there, forever probably. Dubai's future remains in doubt as tourism is devastated by COVID-19. So has Dubai's airline hub become a super spreader to the world? Is Dubai doomed? Will archaeologists of the future find a ghost city in the desert and wonder what happened, like Machu Picchu and Stonehenge? We've learned how to fly, though not as well as the frigate birds, those ancient pirates of the empty ocean in Galapagos, for example, of everlasting fame.
What a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of
jumbo jet in Namibia. A real live jumbo, plus a lion, a safari favorite, well worth its weight in gold. Big money, big cat, big business, until the pandemic predated the tourist trade and aviation was affected worldwide. Travel everywhere was stopped in its tracks, reducing in some cases emissions of CO2 that had been adding to the climate crisis. Some sort of good news there. In the Mediterranean, towns were deserted, hotels derelict, occupied only by sparrows, with reception used by the local farmer as a store. And the only visitors were goats. Talk about social distancing. This couple had the beach to themselves. Santi in Greece, where nesting loggerhead turtles had been crowded out by tourists on the beaches where they had been trying to nest, it was a record breeding season. count of 1,444 nests, the most since 1995. So no us, more turtles. A message there. Our super flyer brings us to another tourist hotspot, where business, like Dubai, has also been affected by COVID-19. This is how it used to be, to those who could afford it. Without that income, protection of this delicate ecosystem may be weakened. You name it, it's on offer. An international menu for international eco-tourists. On the Polaris, anything is possible for a price. For a little heron, breakfast is free, just the cost of a quick sprint at the expense of a crab. Question, how funny is sewing? After breakfast, it's time to meet the famous locals, the very special wildlife of the unique Galapagos Islands in the Pacific, off Ecuador, in South America. The petrel's breakfast is plankton. Iguanas and everything else is hardly shy, a huge bonus for photographers. A flightless cormorant swims in, bringing breakfast to its chick, and the guide spots it.
That's the highest time right there. Oh, it's going to feed the baby. Look, 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 look. Watch it, cormorant. They're waiting for the parents to feed me. Let's go.
Oh, wow.
Oh, he's happy now.
We're right on the equator. Gotta be cool.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue. For me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
The wonderful display of the blue-footed booby. with an appropriate t-shirt. Tourism has come and gone. Not only lots of people in the recent past, but introduced species of animals have upset the delicate balance, evolved over many, many years, as Charles Darwin concluded in his famous theory of natural selection. And there goes a swallow-tailed gull. It's a nocturnal feeder, hence the big eyes, and brings in the catch of the night, a juicy bit of squid. Oh, lovely. Soon it will set off again and join the tourists at sea for supper, along with many other seabirds. To a musical accompaniment. Flying has enabled birds and us to reach every corner of the planet. Frigate birds resemble ancient flying dinosaurs. We try to emulate large flying aviators like vultures and can even join in with them, sharing the sunny air currents. It's one of the many forms of activity tourism, eye to eye with a bearded vulture. Watching an aircraft, possibly an endangered species, because of COVID-19. Now this is the bone breaker, as it's also known. After other species have eaten the soft parts, this one picks up the remains, the bones. It's the last in the queue and knows what to do. In this classic footage, you can see how it breaks bones. It drops them on a favourite rock. It has a formidable digestion system to deal with the bits. Because of its ill-founded reputation in the past of attacking living animals, this fine bird has been persecuted, shot and poisoned. Numbers crashed across Europe in the mountain homes of the Pyrenees and the Alps. But there were some successes out there in the wild. More help was needed, so captive pairs were encouraged to breed. And they did. The chick, pretty big, was to become a bit of a star, particularly with children. And a press conference told the world about a project which was a bit of a gamble because of the species' previous wrong reputation. And feeding it till it was able to fly and join the population already there. Here in the Alps was to be the location for placing the chick in a safe place. This story had a very surprising twist later on.
I don't know. tu es, dis donc.
Bon passage, Jérémy.
Imagine being out for a family walk with a dog and a camera by the Severn Bridge in the west of England. And this takes off before your very eyes. It's a young bearded vulture, but where from? Being so enormous, it was spotted in many places from then on, first on Dartmoor in Devon, afterwards heading south. And by using DNA from a dropped feather, it was shown to have come from the Alps, where it could rejoin the splendid adults. So the project really paid off. Now just imagine, what happened about those chaps who paid us a visit? And that really nice one who joined in. It would be good if they paid us something else, and all those repeats. Well, joking apart, because of the pandemic, less tourists, less money have come in. But the good news is that gorillas have been left to their own devices, including doing what undistracted gorillas do. So there's a good number of babies. And that's promising for the future, as more gorillas attract more tourists and more money for their protection. And no doubt the film crews will be back, adding to the massive media attention that nature seems to be getting. But does it really make any difference to the crisis of biodiversity the whole planet faces? There's been lots and lots of words, but not a lot of action. That's why we've reached Planet Crunch 2020-2021. And be careful with very big animals, especially with this unlikely pairing of a giant tortoise and a young hippo, said to be the most dangerous animal in Africa. In England, Ross Burney is safer.
Called a DJI Osmo. Basically what it means is we use the camera here on, it's like a handheld gimbal to keep things steady. So the effect we're trying to achieve with this is to try and take the effect of being either a shell duck or an egret on the move. And it will stay completely stable as we walk. So my movement's kind of taken out of the shot as it moves along. And you just get some really nice shots, and I can control it via the phone.
All sorts of bits of kit bringing the viewer right in there, like an egret using a cygnet. Does that actually help? On the other hand, if you don't know it's there, but you can see it on the media, maybe it will make a difference. But there's not a lot of time left. And the familiar drone, a wonderful way of getting a bird's eye view. And of course, the sea is full of surprises, less well known than the moon. Too close for comfort? Well, not really. It's a harmless, to us, blue shark. Tourists swim with them. They're media stars, but they're also victims of cruel fishing.
That was the major problem.
And in particular, cruel television. Publicity demonising them relentlessly with inaccurate inflammatory rubbish like assassins, ruthless predators and deadly killers. Well, that's us. The demand for shark fin soup from China involves cutting the fins off whilst they're still alive and chucking them back to die. Sharks are famous because of the film Jaws and its sequels. The author regretted creating such a bad reputation for these ancient creatures, important in the food web for weeding out the weak, thus keeping that stock strong. It's now time to tell the truth. Okay, they're not cuddly like pandas, but it should be possible to divert this enthusiasm to a much better understanding. The media has an important job to do, and not just dumb down for ratings and increase the misplaced hatred of sharks. For press and publicity, the dodo, as Deadass, warns of extinction, but at least parrots are easier to save than sharks. Here in Mauritius, in the Indian Ocean, a team from Jersey Zoo is rearing echo parakeets for later release in the wild.
And I started with the pink pigeon and the Mauritius kestrel, both of which were critically endangered at the time. And the kestrel in the 1970s went down to single figures. In 1974, there were only four individuals left in the wild. And we were able to restore that with captive breeding and reintroduction. One day we might be able to release them. It's grown into a movement on the island, restoring the native habitats, putting back these critically endangered species, and training people, the next generation of young conservation biologists.
This conservation message, including biodiversity, received huge exposure in the autumn of 2020. It was something that Gerald Durrell was very keen on, and today Jersey Zoo continues the good work. That includes lemurs, another photogenic group of species on another large Indian Ocean island, Madagascar. But look at what's happened to the forest here and why. Across Africa, the human population is increasing at a terrifying rate. In Kenya, it doubles every 18 years, with 1 million extra mouths to feed each year. No wonder forests are cut down to grow crops. And that's what the lemurs are up against, literally. One of the most determined and successful conservationists and protector of forests was the late Wangari Maathai.
We humans, as a species, we need the other species much more than they need us. And if other species disappeared, we would definitely not survive on this planet. But if we disappeared, there are many species which would probably say, thank God.
There's a lively, free Planet Crunch book to go with the film series. For details, visit brockinitiative.org. End of part 2 of 3. This is Planet Crunch part 3, including waste and plastic, energy, water, climate change, conservation, and food. Part 3 of 3. Are you a vegetarian like a fruit bat? Probably a link to a pandemic like COVID-19 as we invade their territory. We're a sort of carnivore, the scaly anteater, for sale in a filthy animal market, which can include monkeys, chimpanzees, and even gorillas. We take all sorts. The favorite is the cow. They, with us, have changed the face of the planet. Sheep, which are also vegetarians. Pigs, omnivores. Horse. The French enjoy it. Deer, venison. And then there's bison, red Indians like them. Eskimos enjoy seals, part of the fish food chain. Whereas the Japanese prefer dolphins or whales. Not every country agrees about that. kangaroo on the Barbie in Australia. Bear paws are in demand in Asia, as is so much else. And here comes the most serious carnivore of all, who's been known to have us for dinner, but not this time. The international hamburger here in Brazil is food for many people, sharing this particular spot with leaf-cutting ants, taking their bounty to underground tunnels where a fungus will be grown to feed the ant families down there. Mostly, nature doesn't waste much. Mostly, we do. Plastic and paper litter the streets and can damage wildlife, as well as looking unsightly. The contents of your shopping produce huge amounts of waste, even the trolley itself. Dumped in waterways, these often persistent discards are easily disposed of, hopefully recycled. Downstream, the lobed feet of a coot plod through rubbish brought down the River Thames in London. It's mainly plastic, once considered a breakthrough, but now more of a menace worldwide. It reaches coastal marshes, enters the food chain via fish and shrimps, eaten by herons and egrets. When plastic rubbish reaches the sea, it costs money not only to clear it up off the beach, but in the sea itself. Not good for tourism, not good for nature. Recycling seems a good idea, but some cynics say this is a kind of distraction, so big companies can go on increasing the production of new plastic. Ineos's boss is one of the richest men in Britain. A dead puffin, possibly killed by ingesting nurdles, tiny plastic pellets which occur in millions in our seas. Or plastic ghost nets lost at sea, but continuing to catch and kill fish and other wildlife. We do excrete a lot of waste. More people, less birth control, means the number of humans seem likely to rise, as does our own consumption of plastic. The plastic ocean. More than all the fish in the sea, they say. On the land, waste is piling up too, a side benefit for those ace scavengers, the vultures. But there's always a risk of becoming entangled or picking up poisons. Now, in India, elephants have been seen scavenging at tips, with the stomachs of dead ones full of plastic. Whether it's a bonus for a man in Costa Rica, Central America, or a white stork in Spain in Europe, waste can turn out to be useful. An avian paper delivery. Now, where would you like it put, madam? On a fast-changing planet, storks have managed to adapt pretty well. Though as electricity has spread far and wide, these big slow birds are at risk of collisions and electrocution. Same with vultures. As fossil fuels, that massive big business, goes green, it may mean even more hazards for wildlife. Almost every bit of Britain has been changed by humans, or is changing now into the future. Every plant or insect is there because of us. Some are losers, some are winners. That's certainly true as far as big landscaping projects are concerned. Here in Portugal, home to many white storks, this river, the Guadiana, will be changed drastically with a dam creating the biggest man-made lake in Europe. This is an area of drought, fires and very hot summers due to global heating. The dam is controversial, if only that the very rare Iberian lynx's habitat is threatened by drowning. It's yet another example of wildlife-human conflict, which will increase as humans do. He's doing his best for nature. Water is important too. Climate change is just that. Huge changes in the world's weather affecting nearly every creature and person on planet Earth. Of all the crunches, this has to be the biggest and the most difficult to fix. The winter rains did their job. But plants couldn't adapt. Storks could. They'll benefit from the frogs and later fish that they like to spend time hunting by the water. So far, they've continued to nest on the church in the old village of Lutz. But this will be the last time they'll nest on this Lutz, because it's going to be flooded as the lake of the River Guadiana fills. It's already a ghost village. Just a few people hanging on. A spooky silence. Now. Like they used to. So they're moving the village, a race against the rising waters. It's a classic case of our need for fresh water, for drinking, irrigation, and in fact the basic requirements of human life. A real crunch, that's agua. the old roots to the new. Satellite dish, church, bull ring, a village kit, in fact, with villagers arriving from their drowned homes. And of course, they've got plenty of water on tap. From Turkey for humans, to Spain for otters and the fish they eat. Pure, clean water is a crucial asset wherever you are and whatever your lifestyle. Otters have suffered from hunters and pollution in the past, but they've increased now in many places as rivers and lakes have been cleaned up, or at least some have. To Kenya, it's the lifeblood for local people and the wildlife too. Particularly interesting spot is Lake Bogoria, where scientists monitor this soda lake, famous for its flamingos. Their food is tiny shrimps, which gives the flaming birds their amazing colour. They come to the stream to wash and preen, and some to feed with their amazing upside down filtering beak. Back at the lab, the international team analyse their samples, the food source of sometimes millions of lesser flamingos at the lake. Lakes and rivers are fed by rain, which reaches the sea in due course, depending on dams and man's manipulation, the results of which he tries to measure as the notorious climate change or crisis crunches planet Earth and its inhabitants. Now, birds like this tern migrate across a world of contrasts, affecting their food supply and breeding season, and ours too, as it turns out. With COVID-19, will there be a baby boom? If so, that's bad for the planet, some say. Emissions like these ultimately affect the seasons and climate right across the world. From the Arctic forests and tundra, where melting snow leads to the release of methane, a serious climate crisis gas, to Africa, drought and a dust bowl, a threat to man and vital cattle alike, to Turkey, where white storks bring water from a drying river to their parched chicks. This part of the country is now so hot in the summer that tourism may decline, even more than as a result of COVID-19. Now visitors may stay nearer home as their part of the planet heats up. Though in the winter it may get a lot colder than usual, but there's no such thing as usual, similarly normal. Coot or wagtails on the brink over a dab chick trapped below the ice where it suffocated. snow on a duck's back. Then comes the flooding as spring arrives, now earlier than usual, which may be a problem for birds adapted to seasonal food cycles, including insects and plants. Then back comes another summer. Meanwhile, back up north, the glaciers continue to melt at a record rate, affecting the wildlife, like this lone seal, floating in a rising home. Both north and south poles are changing fast. Sea level rise. These oceanic petrels are safe enough. They can soar over it with ease, though their nest sites may be flooded on land.
And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white. The bright, blessed day, the dark, sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky.
So now for the bad news about sea level rise. Scientists say most coastal cities, in fact any human-occupied place, will be underwater in the near future. And that might just have an effect in Florida, USA, where a certain golf enthusiast with his notorious investments. They did tell him about climate change, but he called it a hoax. A classic in the climate change battle has been the Keystone Pipeline in Canada and the US. Trudeau in Canada agreed his section, so did Trump so far. But President Joe Biden stopped it as soon as he got in. Its incomplete remains, a reminder perhaps, a relic of the collapse of the fossil fuel era. Personal politics and now a form of progress, perhaps, to green energy. Those were the days when the air was disease-free. Tourism ruled the world, crowding the shores of the Mediterranean, despite the risk of skin cancer. Then numbers started to fall, until even the famous shipwrecked beach in Zante, Greece, was almost deserted. But now for some good news. As with turtles on that island, another very special sea animal benefited from the impact of COVID-19 on the travel industry. This is a rescued monk seal called Bardem. Very supple. So is the fish, and away. The caves monk seals try to breed in are now free of tourists and divers, and conservationists are welcomed with open arms. That's all thanks to COVID-19, for once. Remember, there is no vaccine against climate change. Things may have got a bit better in the Mediterranean because of COVID-19, but in England, the seals are doing a lot better. That may not be such good news for fishermen because they try to catch the same prey as those hungry seals. Another human-wildlife conflict. wetlands and their riches are threatened around the world. In Britain, the water vole has been greatly reduced by introduced mink. But native species can be restored, like flower-rich meadows, welcome in various species of egrets, herons. The first, the little egret, has landed back in 1979, and they did well. Then the great white egret dropped in to decorate British wetlands. And the third of these opportunists came to occupy a different niche on or alongside all sorts of livestock, especially cattle and sheep, which flush out insect snacks. Meet the cattle egret. From Africa, they've conquered the planet, a symbol of success. They're not fussy as long as it's food. Try eland or buffalo, a kind of wild cattle, taking aim at a grazing goose. It's a water buck. Gotcha. Beauty and the Beasts, rhinos. And giant forest hogs on the edge of a very special habitat. Where deer hide and peer through a curtain of green. It's the rainforest of Kenya and it needs help. It's home to one of the rarest, most elusive animals on the planet. It's the mountain bongo. It's difficult to know exactly how many inhabit the dense forest. But when one sometimes does emerge, it reveals its beauty. And can it be saved, along with its crucial forest home? Trees are burnt for charcoal, and the more charcoal that's needed for warmth and cooking by more and more people, the more and more forest is cut down. Enda Bibi school children may have the answer. Lots of kids, helped by Solomon, a local bongo expert, who knows the forest really well. It's the Enda Bibi Bongo Club.
But teacher in charge,
yes,
with the pupils, go out of the classroom.
We conserve the animals. The animals, especially the bongo, which are becoming extinct.
I'm in the front line because I'm proud to be a Kenyan. Thank you.
This is the practical gospel about the conservation that we are having. We have about 7,000 seedlings which are ready to be planted. We also have about 10,000 which are not yet ready to be planted. Therefore, we have 70,000 currently.
This is a team effort by young and old, black and white. It's not an easy place to operate in and locate the elusive bongos in the wilds, really wilds. Ex-poachers know the forest well, but the question remains, can they save the mountain bongo? Real name, Bongo Woodley, previous warden on Mount Kenya.
It demonstrates that actually they can survive against all sorts of adversity. So I'd say that's quite a positive. That's actually a very positive thing, because the fact that they are still present and almost impossible to spot, and yet there they are surviving, you know, even if only as a nucleus, I think that's good news, and I think that will be quite important for the success of reintroduction itself.
So on Mount Kenya or other secret places, the bongo may well survive or even thrive with help. It can be done. There's a lively, free Planet Crunch book to go with the film series. For details, visit brockinitiative.org. End of part 3 of 3. What a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.